highlands of Ethiopia. In an isolated mountain fortress, a young man faces a spiritual test. He's about to dedicate his life to protecting the word of God and one of the world's most sacred treasures. It's a mountainous country, isolated from the rest of the continent by its rugged terrain, its ancient wealth, and its unique religious heritage. For as long as anyone can remember, Ethiopians have been a deeply spiritual people. At one time or another, Judaism, Islam, and Christianity have all found a home here. All of them have flourished in the embers of a civilization that was once one of the mightiest powers in all Africa. One of the most powerful of Ethiopia's Christian beliefs is that they are the custodians of the lost Ark of the Covenant, the mysterious vessel thought to contain the actual stone tablets on which the Ten Commandments are carved. For Kibkab Woldemariam, a young trainee priest, this belief is about to play a pivotal role. Sixteen-year-old Kibkab will soon face his first great step on the road to priesthood. In a few weeks, he hopes to take part in the most important ceremony of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, Timkat, the Feast of the Epiphany, celebrating the baptism of Christ. Although Epiphany is celebrated throughout the Christian world, the Ethiopian Timkat ceremony is different. At its heart is the Ark of the Covenant. To be allowed to take part, Kibkab must convince the senior priests of his church that he has total commitment to his calling. There will be no written test, no exams. Kibkab has to prove himself through one criterion alone: faith. It's a tough challenge, and many fail. Each of Ethiopia's 20,000 churches contains a replica of the Ark of the Covenant, the most holy object in the Ethiopian church. The Timkat festival is one of the few times when they are brought out in public. For 6 years, Kibkab has not been ready to take part in Timkat. If the elders question his faith now, it may be many years before he'll be considered again. And this is not the only pressure on Kibkab. He's got a family tradition to live up to.
ያ ወንዶቹ ሁሉም የኔ ጋራ ያ ሶስት ነን ማለት ነው ሁለቱ ጨርሰው ያው ካንተን ላይ ሊደርስ ብለው አንደርሳ ማለት ይችላል እኔ ግን የመጨረሻ ስለሆንኩ ያው ለመدرس ገና እየተማርኩ ነው እንጂ ሁሉም ወንዶቹ እንማራለን
Kibkab practices a form of Christianity that is both ancient and unique to Ethiopia. It's thrived for centuries, sheltered in the sanctuary of the mountains. Yet it was openness to the world that brought Christianity to Ethiopia. The country's location on the Horn of Africa enabled it to dominate lucrative trade routes across the Red Sea and the Indian Ocean. Ethiopia's trading supremacy ended in the 7th century when it lost control of the vital coastal ports. The flow of trade ceased. The mountains and their people lapsed into isolation. But not all of Ethiopia remained isolated. The name of the modern capital, Addis Ababa, means new flower, an appropriate choice. Since Addis was founded in the late 19th century, a cosmopolitan city has blossomed. The population has grown to around 3 million, representing all Ethiopia's peoples and religions. And new ideas keep the capital growing. Every year, thousands flock here to seek their fortune. Artisan Mesfan was just 10 years old when he left his rural village for Addis. Artisan came to earn an all-important extra income for his farming family back home. He seized an opportunity and, at 15, he's now his family's main breadwinner. Atusan adapted quickly to city life. He and his friends are Goragi people, renowned entrepreneurs. Atusan works 12 hours a day, 6 days a week. He sends most of his money home, but always puts enough aside to afford the once-a-year trip home for Maskal, the Garagi's most important holiday. Like Thanksgiving, Maskal is a time for family reunions, and it's getting close. Kibkab also works hard, but his is a life of worship and study. He goes to a church school in his hometown of Lalibela, in the mountains of northern Ethiopia. Kibkab needs to study hard. His teacher will be one of those who have the final say as to whether he's ready to take part in the Timkat festival. And Kibkab's teacher is his own father. His father knows the dedication it takes to become a priest. He makes no exceptions, not even for his own sons. There's little formal structure to Kibkab's education. There's no end-of-year exam. Study is constant. Learning the scriptures by heart is in itself a monumental task. But Kibkab must also learn a new language, Ge'ez. It's one of Africa's oldest written scripts. Around 1,000 years ago, Ge'ez died out as an everyday language and is now solely used by the Ethiopian church. A language seemingly frozen in time, it takes years to learn. The inspiration to succeed is all around Kibkab. Stories of the great Ethiopian saints are part of the bedrock of the church, demonstrating how intense faith can grow from humble origins. One of Kibkab's favorite saints, Yared, developed a unique system of musical notation for the church. His music was so beautiful that even the king was captivated. Transfixed by Yared's singing, the king leaned on his spear, piercing the saint's foot, but Yared sang on, unaware of the pain until he'd finished his song. Saint Yared has inspired generations of priests. Like Kibkab, Yared was once a struggling student. But Kibkab has some ambitions his father's generation would never have contemplated. He's thinking of leaving Lalibela to study abroad. But unless Kibkab can show the dedication necessary for Timkat, his ambitions will remain nothing but dreams. Like his father, he may never leave the mountains. This heavily carved landscape has isolated more than its people. It has also provided a sanctuary for its wildlife. The Gelada baboon is the only grazing primate in the world and is unique to the Horn of Africa. Here, at altitudes of 7,000 feet and above, the Gelada feed on the mountain grasses. The Gelada form larger groups than any other species of primate. At times, bands of up to 600 animals graze like herds of cattle on the mountain slopes. The mountains are also a rigorous training ground for future priests.
Tumert
Kibkab lives with 10 other students. They earn their meals the traditional way, by begging for food. Today, Kibkab has volunteered to gather the daily bread and get past the village sentries. Enduring physical hardship is seen as a necessary step in Kibkab's spiritual development. So is learning to accept charity, especially from villagers who often have little food to spare. Fortunately for the young novitiates, most of the people around Lalibela are devout Christians who will give whatever they can in exchange for a blessing. Today's labors produce small results. An empty stomach makes studying even harder. In Addis Ababa, the shoe shining is getting a little competitive. Artisan and his friends want to return home from Maskal with as many presents for their families as they can afford. Each boy strives to do his best. Artisan's home village lies 120 miles from Addis. Here, people are crowded together in small pockets of farmland, sandwiched between the mountains. In Garagi culture, owning property is of central importance, and Artisan's father is putting his son's money to work. The Garagi call themselves the people of the Enset, a relative of the banana plant. They are the only people in the world to grow Enset as a crop. Although it bears no edible fruit, the pulp of a single plant can feed a family for up to 20 days. What's more, it's something of a wonder plant. Every part of it is used for building materials, household implements, even medicine. On the oldest continent on Earth, the pinnacles and gorges of Ethiopia are a relatively recent addition. More than 40 million years ago, colossal upsurges of lava spilled out onto the existing plain. The weathering power of wind and water then fashioned this distinctive landscape. All over Ethiopia, the mountains sustain isolated pockets of animals that have evolved to fit a particular niche in the local ecology. high altitude environment of the Bale Mountains is home to the endangered Ethiopian wolf. The wolf is trapped here because of its reliance on one principal food source, grassland rodents. This dependence is one reason the Ethiopian wolf is now on the brink of extinction. Tens of thousands of years ago, the highlands were cooler and covered in scrubby grassland. Wolves and rodents were plentiful. With such easy pickings, the wolf gradually lost its ability to hunt larger animals cooperatively with other members of a pack. It became a lone hunter, dependent on rodents for survival. Then, as the earth warmed, the low-lying areas became too hot for grassland. It disappeared from the plains and is now found only amid the cooler peaks of the mountains. Today, the wolf and the rodents are stranded together among the pinnacles, their last surviving refuge. There are only a few hundred wolves left. Even with the protection of recent conservation measures, the future of these pups hangs in the balance. The isolation of the mountains has also given sanctuary to Christian hermits. Many come to fast and pray. But a few, such as Abba Defar, come with a holy mission. Abba Defar was once a weaver and a family man. Then in 1959, he had a dream. In it, the Holy Spirit showed him a mountain church carved out of the rock. For the next 30 years, the dreams kept coming. Abba Defar struggled to understand them. Finally, he had a vision, and the message became clear.
Subsaba ihona ya tilik subsaba and betre meskil batawi tenesto ndi halle yaze elibelu asamai kokkab work kokkab worrede work meskil worrede ila bahala la yale ndew ba ndih betre meskil yaazo tenesto yagacha የተቀረው ቁጭ እንዳለ ነው አዚ ወዲ ያለል ታይቀልታል ዋላ ቀና ብዬ ሳያት ሀሰማይ የተወለበለ ቤት መጣለች ያቺ ወርቅ መስቀል የተባለችው ተመጣለች ቀና ብዬ ሳያት የተወለበለ ቤት መጣለች ዝቅ ስትል እርግብ ደበኔ ሆናታለች ያቺ እርግብ ደበኔ መታህኔ ላይ ታርፋለች ያቺ እርግብ ደበኔ መታህኔ ላይ ታርፋለች የዚህ ያለ ታርግብ ስታርፍበት በአባስ ነው የሚመረጠው ሲባል ሰማለው በዱሮ
Abba Defar believed the white dove, symbol of the Holy Spirit, was commanding him to carve churches out of the solid mountain with his bare hands. It seemed impossible, but a second vision persuaded him that he would succeed. As an Orthodox believer, Abba Defar had no choice but to obey. Abba Defar has now finished four churches, each cut by hand from the rock, and the visions keep on coming. He suffers, but he works on, driven and yet strengthened by his faith. In building his churches on direct instruction from God, Abba Defar is following an ancient tradition. There are rock-hewn churches all over Ethiopia. But there's no site more impressive than the city of Lalibela. Kibkab's church is one of 11 churches, each cut straight into the volcanic rock. They were built by the 12th century king Lalibela, who had a vision of the holy city of Jerusalem. In a week's time, this Ethiopian Jerusalem will throng with crowds gathering for Timkat. But Kibkab doesn't yet know if he will take part. He can only hope, study, and pray. The Ethiopian people have a long tradition of selectively embracing and integrating foreign influences into their culture. Christianity arrived via one of the oldest cities in Ethiopia, Aksum. Aksum was not originally a Christian place. More than 2,000 years old, it was once the seat of a great trading civilization. These architectural achievements rival those of ancient Egypt. But the Aksum monoliths are unique. The carvings evoke the design of palaces in a city long since disappeared. The tallest monolith now lies broken, but it was once the largest single block of carved stone in the world. In the 4th century, the Aksumites embraced a new idea, Christianity. 300 years later, the distant trading ports fell under Arab control. Cut off from the sea, Aksum began to die. Its secrets disappeared into the earth. Today, these monuments stand among the humble houses of a small town. As Aksum crumbled, Christianity fled to the mountains. where it has remained essentially unchanged by time. The landscape of Ethiopia not only played a critical role in the survival of Christianity, it has also protected the entire Ethiopian nation. These fortress walls have kept out would-be conquerors. Ethiopia remains the only African country never to be fully colonized by foreign powers. In Addis Ababa, the Shushine boys return to their room. It's time for a few hands of cards and a celebratory cup of coffee. Coffee originated in Ethiopia and remains one of its most popular drinks. Artisan knows his mother's homegrown coffee is the best. And by this time tomorrow, he'll be sharing a pot with the rest of his family. Mescal coincides with the coming into bloom of a small yellow daisy, the mescal daisy. It symbolically announces the end of the big rains, a time when the roads become passable again and sons can return home. The boys have done well this year. They'll be going home laden with gifts. Back in Artisan's village, preparations are well underway. Artisan's brother, Negatu, decorates their house with mescal daisies and other flowers, a practice that harks back to a time when the Garagi worshipped the seasons. Today, mescal prayers reflect what remains important to them. Every year, the village elders recount the story of mescal. It's an old Christian legend. It tells how the cross, the true cross, on which Jesus was crucified, was found. According to the local legend, the world was suffering terrible natural disasters. People worried that the land was plagued and would never be fertile again. In their desperation, they consulted a wise man. He prophesied that peace would only be restored when the true cross was found. It's also traditional to drink coffee, an essential part of any social occasion. But today, it's hard for Adusan's mother and grandmother to concentrate. They're too busy listening for the bus that will bring Adusan home. In Addis, the boys just have time to do some last-minute preparation of their own. Their families hold them in high esteem, so it's worth spending a little of their hard-earned cash on looking good. This year, Atasan is feeling particularly proud. For the first time in 5 years, he's made enough money for his family to afford a sacrificial bull for Maskal. Even at local prices back home, the money needed for a bull uses the earnings from polishing 2,000 pairs of shoes. Today, Artisan is returning as a shoeshine boy. But like Kibkab, he too has ambitions. The boys have worked hard to afford this journey, so it's understandable that pride in their success spills over into a little good-natured rivalry. While Atasan and his friends enjoy their well-earned holiday, Kibkab works on. On a rare day off from studying, he must help out on the family farm. Tomorrow is Timkat. It's almost time for Kibkab to hear the verdict of his father and the other senior priests. But his future does not hinge entirely on their decision. If there is a time for doubt, it's now. Kibkab could choose not to follow in the family footsteps. He could become a farmer like his cousins, or go to Addis to work. Ultimately, the decision to continue on the path to priesthood is his alone. After 10 months in the city, Atasan is home. Officially, his visit is for Maskal, a religious occasion. But the deeper truth is evident in each embrace. Maskal is a time to renew the bonds of family love. Thanks to Artisan's hard work, his father is able to buy a sacrificial bull. Not every family is so fortunate, but true to their deep community spirit, the villagers come together for the blessing and sacrifice of the bulls. In this way, the families who are unable to afford a bull don't miss out. It's a moment to give thanks and a time to celebrate. Today, the breadwinner of the family can relax, reassured that all is well at home. Each village lights its own Maskal bonfire. In Maskal, Christianity did not replace the old. Rather, it was absorbed and melded with beliefs so ancient they cannot be dated. It is a celebration of life, fertility, and family. As such, it is important to all Garagi people, Muslim and Christian alike. Artisan, ever the entrepreneur, may build a new future for himself in Addis. But like every Garagi, he will always try to return home from Maskal. In Lalibela, Kibkab's long months of prayer and study have been rewarded. He's been chosen to accompany the tablet, the replica of the Ten Commandments, during the Timkat ceremony. Kibkab will take his place among an entourage of senior priests. It is an auspicious landmark in his spiritual development. But it is also a deeply private moment a moment of personal revelation. The priesthood is not really a career to be chosen like any other, nor is it the decision of others. Kibkab is here because it's where he wants to be. Christians from all over Ethiopia come to the ancient city of Lalibela for the festival of Timkat, hoping for a glimpse of the tablets. To come close to the tablet is to come close to the word of God itself. It is this belief that has given faith to generations. The replicas of the Ten Commandments are considered so sacred that no one is ever permitted to gaze upon them. Even during Timkat, they must remain completely covered. The tablets of the 11 churches of Lalibela emerge, carried on the heads of the most senior priests. From the labyrinths, they form a procession and make their way to the baptism pool. Scenes like this were described in the Bible when the Israelites welcomed Moses' return from Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments. Kibkab may realize his dreams. Someday he may visit Jerusalem. But he has already taken his first step on a great spiritual journey. From now on, there will be no turning back. Celebrating the baptism of Christ, the faithful are themselves blessed by the holy water of Lalibela. awe-inspiring mountains of the Horn have nurtured Ethiopian culture for thousands of years. Religion has grown strong in this landscape. With what is claimed to be the Ark of the Covenant hidden from view in Aksum, the truth behind these incredible beliefs remains uncovered. There is evidence that a mighty civilization flourished here. But for the Christians of Ethiopia, no proof is needed, only faith.